So I should make sure, yeah. Samuel 17.
Yeah, he's finishing the last. He's coming up to the last verse.
This, we kind of almost finished it, didn't we? Okay. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Blessed Lord, you've given us your holy scriptures for our learning. Grant that this day we may so hear them. Read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that by patience and comfort of your holy word, we would embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life, which you've given us through your dear Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray.
Amen.
David ran and stood over the Philistine, took his sword, drew it out of its sheath, and killed him and cut off his head with it. When the Philistines saw their champion was dead, they fled. And the men of Israel and Judah rose with a shout and pursued the Philistines as far as Gath and the gates of Ekron, so that the wounded Philistines fell on the way. And the people of Israel came back from chasing, and they plundered their camp. And David took the head of the Philistine and brought it to Jerusalem, and he put his armor in his tent. Even though at the time Jerusalem was under Jebusite control, and there is some scholars that dispute that verse of bringing the head to Jerusalem, but there's no reason to kind of doubt it. The verb structure doesn't give room for it to be that this was maybe a description of some future event. For some reason, he took it to Jerusalem. But and the first thing he does with the head, really, of Goliath is he takes it to Saul. Do you want to read, Ted? 55 through 58.
Yes. And as soon as Saul saw David go out against the Philistine, he said to Abner, the commander of the army, "Abner, whose son is this youth?" And Abner said, "As your soul lives, O king, I do not know." And the king said, "Inquire whose son the boy is." And as soon as David returned from the striking down of the Philistine, Abner took him and brought him before Saul with the head of the Philistine in his hand. And Saul said to him, "Whose son are you, young man?" And David answered, "I am the son of your servant, Jesse the Bethlehemite."
Okay. And, why was Saul so interested in whose son David was? Because what had happened? Other than that David killed Goliath. But what was the consequences of David killing Goliath? Do you remember? Saul had made a promise.
He put out a bounty, basically.
Right. What was the bounty?
Raise up the man and build him and his family and give him a wife.
And give him one of his daughters as his wife, right. So the guy, this guy, David, was going to be entering into the family, to the royal family, through marriage. So that's why he's inquiring, what kind of stalker do we have here? Now, if Saul really knew his Bible stories, his Genesis, what would he know about David as opposed to him himself and his own family? Whose line was the king of Israel supposed to go through? And really, because whose line was the Messiah supposed to go through? Well, what family, what clan of Israel?
Judah.
Judah, right? If you look at Genesis 49, I think it is, Yeah, David, Jacob's final discourse before he dies. Genesis 49, verses 8 through 10. Would you like to read? Or you got it? You got it, Vicar? Go for it.
Judah, your brothers shall praise you. Your hand shall be on the neck of your enemies. Your father's son shall bow down before you. Judah is a lion's cub. From the prey, my son, you have gone up. He stooped down, he crouched as a lion and as a lioness. Who dares rouse him? The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet, until tribute comes to him, and to him shall be the obedience of the peoples.
Okay, go ahead, 11 and 12. Too.
Binding his foal to the vine and his donkey's colt to the choice vine, he has washed his garments in wine and his vesture in the blood of grapes. His eyes are darker than wine and his teeth whiter than milk.
What's that kind of a picture of, that those last verses?
I can't help but think of the atonement with him being washed in.
In his own blood.
It says wine, but it's, you know, it's going to
right,
be red.
Right, exactly. The blood of grapes. It actually uses the word blood. Blood of grapes. His vesture in the blood of grapes, his garments in wine. And he binds his foal to the vine and his donkey's colt to the choice vine. Reminds you of Palm Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, if Saul knew his Genesis, which he probably does not, he would know the scepter shall not depart from Judah and the ruler's staff from between his feet. So the significance of saying, I'm from Jesse the Bethlehemite, would be, I'm from the tribe of Judah. That would be the significance we should take from it. Because now the royal, and of course God has already had David anointed to be the future king. Saul wouldn't have understood all this yet. But somebody does in Saul's family. Somebody does get it, and we're going to go on and read this. I wanted to ask, what's the significance, do you think, of David coming into Saul holding the head of Goliath?
It's like Jesus after the cross, what did he tell us?
Oh, that'd be great.
You proclaim a victory.
What, Ted? That's a good one.
Yeah.
I like that. That's a four picture of Christ. The descent into hell. That's an interesting thought, Ted. That's really good. I didn't go there, but that's great.
Yeah, well,
thank you.
And I should say Saul had an evil spirit.
Well, yeah, Saul has an evil spirit, doesn't he? You're right. Wow, maybe I should call you up for exegetical insights. But good job.
Yeah,
really nice. And what's the other significance of David standing there with the head of Goliath and Saul not? What's the message? David did his...
He did the dirty work.
He did the king's duty, and Saul did not do it. Does David, in this passage, does he ask to be made king? Does he say, I should be the king? What's he say? I am the son of your servant, Jesse the Bethlehemite. So even at this point, David is not there to take what is actually supposed to be his eventually, but he still respects the person that God still has in the office.
He'll take over the kingship, though.
He'll take it when God gives it.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
So God hasn't seen fit to give it quite yet. Okay? Let's move on to chapter 18, 1 Samuel 18, beginning with the first verse. Let's read the first five verses. Who would like to? Would you like to read?
Sure. As soon as he had finished speaking to Saul, the soul of Jonathan was knit to the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him and his own soul. And Saul took him that day and would not let him return to his father's house. And then Jonathan made a covenant with David because he loved him as his own soul. And Jonathan stripped himself of the robe that was on him and gave it to David, and his armor, and even his sword, and his bow, and his belt. And David went out and was successful wherever Saul sent him, so that Saul set him over the men of war, and was good in the sight of the people, and also in the sight of Saul's servants.
Thanks. All right, let's talk about this passage. Who is Jonathan?
Saul's son.
Son, and probably the heir of his kingdom. So he would be the next in line to the throne, right? Normally. But what we've heard from before is that Jonathan was a believer in and a faithful to Yahweh. If you remember the story in 1 Samuel 14, where Jonathan and his young assistant go and single-handedly or double-handedly defeat the Philistines at a camp. And he kind of goes crazy and under the Spirit of the Lord and kills a bunch of people, Philistines, one after the other, even though they were all alone. While Saul and his watchmen looked from a distance. What does Jonathan understand, though, from this passage, being a faithful to Yahweh, faithful to the Lord? What does it seem Jonathan seems to understand about David? What does he do? His soul is knit to the soul of David, and he loves him as if he is his own soul. I mean, you know, this is, of course, love your neighbor as you love yourself, but even more, it's their one in their brotherhood in faith and trust.
The Spirit of the Lord that's on David, I think, draws them together.
Right. The Holy Spirit draws them together as brothers. And then Jonathan, verse 3, makes a covenant. He does two things. They make a covenant, an agreement together with David because he loved him as his own soul. And that covenant is described a little later. If we look ahead, let's see here. 1 Samuel 20, verse 8. Who's talking? David's talking. Therefore, deal kindly with your servant, for you have brought your servant into a covenant of the Lord with you. If there's any guilt in me, kill me yourself, or why should you bring me to your father? And Jonathan says, no, far be it from me. Why would I do that? So this is when Saul has been chasing after to kill David. Which we'll get to pretty soon. Also, verse 42 of that same chapter. Then Jonathan said to David, they kissed one another, wept with one another, David weeping the most. And Jonathan said to David, go in peace, because we have sworn both of us in the name of the Lord, saying, the Lord shall be between me and you, and between my offspring and your offspring forever. So David's children and Jonathan's children would be one with each other. Okay? They would look out for each other's families. That's brotherhood. That's Christian brotherhood. That's in the Holy Spirit Brotherhood, right? Okay. And David indeed will do that after Jonathan's death. He will look kindly on Jonathan's son, Mephibosheth.
It's not quite as catchy as Jonathan.
Yeah, not quite as catchy a name as Jonathan. You're right. Secondly, Jonathan gives David what? His robe, which to have a robe in 1 Samuel is a sign of you're either a prophet or a king. You know, the only people that are described as having a robe are prophets, the prophet Samuel, or the royalty of Saul and his family. The notable place where the word robe will come up again is when David catches Saul in a cave, and David is hiding in the cave, and Saul enters the cave, doesn't know he's there, and David cuts off a corner of his royal robe in the dark, and could have killed Saul, but didn't. So Jonathan gives David his robe, his armor, even his sword, his bow, and his belt. Why does Jonathan do this? Is it just purely out of love? I really care about David, so I'm going to give him all this stuff. What's he saying? What do you think he's saying, Ted? What do you think Jonathan's saying about David?
I guess he's kind of concerned with what he's already going to do.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Well, which was what was going to. What was going to.
Give him his kingly robe.
Yeah.
But he's not a king, but he'd be getting the robe that he would normally have had from Saul.
Right.
He gives him everything. Pretty much distinguishes him as the heir.
Right, he gives him all the signs.
As if he's telling him he's his equal.
Right, well, and even more than that, I think he's telling him you're above me now. You, these belong to you, not to me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't wonder if what the prophet did with David was known at all.
Well, I think it was known by those who. Which is a person who has what? Belief, faith, trust, right? Who listens to the prophet. For whatever reason, even though his father had an evil spirit, the Lord, the Holy Spirit, was still at work in Jonathan. Which is a great thing. God can make the lemonade out of the lemons, right? Okay. What's that?
I wish the same thing for Mark Zuckerberg's children.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know if he has any children.
Well, anybody. Yeah, I don't know. A lot of people that we're seeing in today's culture and society. Yeah, you really pray that the sins of the fathers are not visited upon the children. But that's what God's warning is, right? In Exodus?
Yeah, like the 10th generation, especially as a nation.
Right.
How many generations it visits.
Right.
Yeah. I just had something I'm curious to see about that Firefox this morning. Has a thing to protect you from tracking you with Facebook. It's a container. Facebook tracking. It's concerned about the privacy of not just to that, but the messenger and a couple other.
Yeah. It's almost impossible, I would think, not to be tracked in some way.
It's not Facebook, it'll be your Apple iPhone or your Google or
Everybody's going to be tracking you.
Get rid of it all or
deal with it. Back to the Bible. That's okay. This is how Jonathan treats David. Jonathan's relationship with David. What's the contrast between how does Saul have a relationship with David in this passage? What does Saul do?
Saul just basically uses David.
Yeah, right. Saul just uses David. What's the first verse there say about Saul and David?
Are we on 6?
18 verse 2. Look back.
Oh. And Saul took him that day and would not let him return to his father's house.
Yeah. So if you remember, David is told by Jesse, take this bread and this cheese and the good stuff to your brothers and to the army, and then return back, right? That would be the natural order of things. David would owe his father a journey back, especially being the youngest son. But Saul does not permit David even to go home. He immediately uses him, as you said so well,
for his own... That's kind of smart, because he just killed him.
Right.
He killed Goliath.
Right.
Better to have him on his team.
And I better play the, keep playing the, rolling the dice, you know? It's kind of like a hot person at the craps table. You better keep rolling the dice. Yeah, I mean, there was no one hotter on the scene than David having killed Goliath, right?
And it's odd that Saul could be a little bit cold of a person than have a son that is so intelligent.
And so warm. So heartfelt.
Yeah, so maybe that generation thing didn't apply here.
Right. Well, what was the difference between Jonathan and Saul? Saul has been taken over by
an evil spirit.
And Jonathan seems to have the gift of the Holy
Saul
Spirit.
Saul wasn't born with an evil spirit either.
When
he was made king, he was
given the Holy Spirit.
He was given everything that he should have had.
Right. What's he done with this, the Holy Spirit?
He's forsaken it.
He's rejected it, right? Yeah. He
that
rejected.
Could be the evil spirit.
Well,
to do that.
That whatever the cause is,
it'd be probably hard for a body to have both in there at the same time.
Well, yeah,
I'm sure the one left before the other.
The one left before the other, and that's the problem. Saul's allowed his sinful flesh to take over. Yeah. Okay. And what else does Saul, Jonathan gives David, makes the covenant with him, gives David the robe, the sword, the bow, the belt, the armor. David goes out and is a successful warrior. Saul sends him wherever, and Saul sets him over the men of war. And, of course, that becomes good in the sight of all the people, which is an ominous sign, because in the next passage, good in the sight of all the people is not so hot for Saul. And it's going to cause a bad problem here. So let's go on. Verses 6 through 9. Who would like to read? Okay, Ted.
Saul's jealousy of David. As they were coming home, when David returned from striking down the Philistine, the women came out of all the cities of Israel, singing and dancing to meet King Saul, with tambourines and songs of joy, and with musical instruments, and the women sang to one another as they celebrated. Saul had struck down his thousands, and David his 10,000s. And Saul was very angry and saying the same, displeasing him. He said, "They have ascribed to David's 10,000s, and to me they have ascribed thousands, and what more can be? Can he have but the kingdom, and saw I David from the day on."
Oh my. So the short song these women sing in celebration, which is not new, if you remember the God's victory over Pharaoh's army at the Red Sea. A woman sings and dances. What was her name? Do you remember? Moses' sister.
Yeah.
Miriam. Miriam danced and sang. And so there's other examples in the Old Testament. But the short song the women sing is kind of this numerical saying where one line introduces a number and the next line introduces a higher number. So thousands, ten thousands. There's other psalms and things where these things used, but the implication is what? It might not have intended to insult Saul, but the problem is they paired the two together. And what have they said about each one? Whose victory is a greater victory?
David's.
Right.
Well, they're just seeing what... They're just saying what they see.
Right.
They're not purposely
right.
manufacturing anything. This is indicative of what's...
And what's true, right. So David's credited with 10 times the accomplishments of Saul, but who had been king for many years, but now David already is outranking his master as most decorated in combat. But he deserves it, right?
Sure.
I mean, the head of Goliath is easily 10 times more than Saul ever accomplished, right?
Even when Saul did what he did, he had to have Samuel come up and finish the job for him because he wouldn't do it.
Right, exactly. Right, with the king of Gath or whatever it was, right?
Yeah, remember King Spain.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. What about what in history the leader stopped being leading the battles?
Well,
a lot more recently than this.
The Vikings, they all, you know, all of the leaders led them into battle. But, you know, today, of course, you don't see Trump out there.
He's
not leading the battle. He's not physically.
No, they've got plenty of guys underneath them that have the expertise to do that.
I think it's good to know what point in history did that stop.
That's a good question, but
I know,
probably Napoleon.
Let's see,
maybe the
1800s.
We'll see.
You think?
At least in Europe. And
yeah, because
I mean, you think of the Indians, that the chiefs were always up in the hill when the Westerners showed. They didn't actually go down there.
Well, in some of the Westerns, the Indian chiefs.
That's true.
But the problem is, if you kill the chief or you kill the king in the battle, what happens to the army underneath him?
And some they only have to kill the leaders.
Right, they fall apart and the leadership crumbles. I know in the 30 Years' War, King Adolphus of Sweden led his Lutheran troops into battle against the Catholics and was killed on the field of battle, even though his army eventually won the battle, right? But, and the Lutherans went into the battle singing A Mighty Fortress and all this kind of stuff.
Yeah,
and here, though, it's probably
but they, right, they should have probably held King Adolphus back, but he was very into it.
But seeing David didn't leading this army was probably very good for the morale of his soldiers.
I have another.
Which might be another reason why they attribute more deaths.
A little later in the Bible, there will be an example where David will not go with his army to lead them into battle like he was supposed to. You know what that story is? Yeah, and he gets in trouble because while he's at home being lazy, he spies out Bathsheba taking a bath, and he lusts after her, and the whole David and Bathsheba thing happens. And the Bible is very specific at the beginning of that story. They say when kings were in the spring were supposed to be out of battle with their troops, David, meanwhile, was at home.
Well, it's really Saul's fault.
But anyway, back to this.
Life. He didn't like pick one.
Right, and well,
he had more than one way. Even before Bathsheba.
Yeah, right. Exactly. Well, anyway, so Saul, how does he react to being credited with 10 times less than David? He's very angry. The saying displeases him. And he eyes him with the evil eye. He keeps his eye on him because, right, he's jealous. He suspects that David is out to get his kingdom. Verses 10 and 11. The next day, a harmful spirit from God rushed upon Saul, and he raved within his house while David was playing the lyre. And as he did day by day, Saul had his spear in his hand, and Saul hurled the spear, for he thought, I will pin David to the wall, but David evaded him twice. Goodness. So two times he apparently throws the spear at David.
You gotta wonder if he was sitting there playing the lyre, if he just like moved over a little bit and kept playing, and Saul went to the
right.
Picked it up and did it again. He's like, okay, I get the message here.
Yeah, how sad.
Because he wouldn't have been able to just run off the first time until he knew he was being.
Good thing David
didn't just sing him. Yeah, was David so much into his music that he was oblivious to what had happened?
Well, Saul orders him at least later to play for him, doesn't he? So he's under the king's command.
Right. It's really a pathetic thing, isn't it, though?
Yeah.
This attempt to kill David.
Well, it shows even more that David is brave and loyal, even as
right.
The spirit
is because
he had a harmful spirit in him.
Right. Right.
God must have wanted him to do that.
Well, God, you're right. God gives him over into judgment. God gives Saul over into the wickedness of his flesh. Why? Because when God does these things and allows people to kind of live in their wicked flesh, he is actually trying to drive the person to do what? To recognize their sin and to repent. Very nice. Yes, you're absolutely right. Right. Right.
Same.
It shows even more the generosity of the Holy Spirit when even in the face of having spears huffed at him, he won't leave until it's very clear.
Right. Right.
He faced a giant. He's brave.
Yeah. He has God's.
He's brave because the Lord is
with him.
He's with him and is his trust.
Which is the next verse? Would you read verses 12 through 16 and we'll finish with that?
Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with him, but had departed from Saul. So Saul removed him from his presence and made him a commander of 1,000. And he went out and came in before the people. And David had success in all his undertakings, for the Lord was with him. And when Saul saw that he had great success, he stood in fearful awe of him. But all Israel and Judah loved David, for he went out and came in before them.
Okay. So Saul sends him out, gets him out of the house, and puts him in charge of 1,000 of the army. And Israel and Judah love David. People are recognizing David as the real leader of Israel, of God's people.
Well, ironically, Saul's setting him up to appear that way.
Yeah.
Actually telling him to do his job.
Mm-hmm.
Getting popular support because he's with the people.
Verse 15 is interesting. When Saul saw that David had great success, he stood in fearful awe of him. A fearful awe. Kind of like, this must be God's man. in one, there's a flash of a thought there that maybe Saul is dawning on him. Right. And in the next passage, Saul will offer David one of his daughters. And we'll read that story next week. I think we're about 40 minutes, and I think we can call it a day at this point. We'll continue with 1 Samuel 18, verses 17 to 30 next week. Sound good?
Sure.
Let's close with a blessing. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be and abide with you always.
Amen.
Amen.
Well,
actually, it will turn the thing off here.
Well, I mentioned it,
or maybe most people have been through it already. Never thought of that.
There's people watching. Hi.